Well, right back to the fundamentals, the bare fact of things, and don't complicate it in any way at all. If I have an idea about who I am, you understand, built up out of memory, out of conditioning, these ideas about who I am are controlling me. All unconscious. They have to be unconscious, because if I was conscious of how I am being controlled by what my fathers told me 30 years ago, 40 years ago, what my grandfather said in a moment of great emotion when I was 12 years old, if I'm not aware that I am being controlled by this thing that happened all these years ago, then I am what? I am asleep, I'm a slave, and I am very unhappy. If I can see that all I have called myself has been built out of time, out of memory. You do understand this is a fact, what we're talking about. You understand this is not philosophy. This is not religion. You're not being pleased. This is the fact. And we're going to go into that in a minute, this idea of pleasing yourself. At the second I understand everything we're talking about, this gives me courage to die to the idea that I exist as this illusory human being. Listen, so you won't make a mistake. I have to go straight through hell to get there. Do you understand what this means? I can't avoid it. If I try to avoid it, then I'll go to a group meeting where they flatter you, where they tell you to do stupid little things, which I think we covered once. Everybody grasp hands and say the magic word for today. This is easy. Anybody can hold hands and say the magic word for today. We are entering hell in order to get through it, to get out on the other side. And this is the only way. There's no avoidance. You can't go around on either side, left or right. You go right through the center of it. And you know what you'll find eventually? It's an astonishing thing. It'll knock you over when you see it. You get up. It's very easy. It's easy to get up. You see that this hell that you went through was strictly one in your own mind. You think that husband or wife is making a hell of your life. You're making it yourself. You think that terrible thing that happened to you made a hell of your life. Even your own mistake. You made a mistake when? 5 years ago? 20 years ago? I wonder if you're gonna really accept this when I tell you this. The entire thing is canceled out. Not the memory of the fact of it. You don't cancel out the fact that you or I did that very stupid thing 5 years ago. That happened. We know it is a fact. You are freed from it emotionally, and you're freed of it as far as your idea of yourself is concerned. Because the last thing you will do, and the last thing I will do, is to give up the idea that I was this very stupid person who got into this relationship. I thought I had it made, and I went right into it, and the honeymoon was over in 4 or 5 days. What a stupid idiot I am. You must never label yourself stupid or an idiot, because that is vanity. That is egotism. That is clinging to you. Do you see this much? Do you see the vanity in calling yourself names and condemning yourself? Do you see the vanity in feeling guilty and ashamed? Churches hold people by deliberately imposing shame on them. This is how they keep you a slave. We have seen through it. This is the end of that. We're going to get out of it. Now, as a subject for open discussion, let's take a very, very common phrase and dig deep into it. And comment in every way. Each of you are going to respond to this in a different way. It's very valuable. There's an old saying that it's the truth that hurts. You've heard that, have you not? It's the truth that hurts. In our work, our inner work, what does that mean? How can we apply it? Think of this as a topic of conversation. It's the truth that hurts. Now, I'll start it off with something, and then I want you to contribute to it. In this group, I can hurt you. This gentleman can hurt this gentleman. This lady can hurt this lady. This lady, this lady. Everyone can hurt each other. Now, do you know what I'm getting at? If it's the truth that hurts, then it's also the truth that heals. There's no separation of the two. The truth that hurts is the truth that heals. If you tell me that I ask a question in this group in order to sound impressive, and I mentioned several books I'd read, and I quoted from somebody, and you said, maybe tactful, sure, we don't hit each other with clubs, because we couldn't take it. If you could take it, you could get hit with a club, but we can't. So gently, the medicine is mixed with a little sugar, but not compromise. That's not compromise. Tact is not compromise, because that probably entered your mind. And you tell me that I asked this question in order to impress the rest of the class, but didn't know it, and that hurts me. I have been helped, because I have now been given the opportunity to die to a false need to impress you, which means that I'm living from an illusion of having a self that needs to impress you. Because if I impress you, my tricky little mind is thinking I will get all other kind of benefits from it. What do I want from you? Well, I look at every one of you and I see what I want. From one, I want your admiration, another friendship, another I want compliments, maybe another I want help in moving my furniture tomorrow. Who knows? The mind is endlessly tricky. We all want things. And you tell me that, and I take it rightly. I will die to this false image I have that I am an impressive person. And when I do that, I also die to a little bit of the hell that I have lived in. Then, I don't need to, now listen to this, I don't need to impress anyone at all, because there is no one here existing needing to impress you with how intelligent I am, how beautiful I am, how shapely I am, on and on. There's no one there. When there is no one there, I am free of you because I am free of myself. All my relationships with every other human being are perfect as far as I am concerned. They may not be perfect with me. You may not be perfect with me because you have your work to do. I am perfect with myself, and if the word perfect bothers you, it is because you are still thinking in terms of imperfection, which means you still think you can reform your old nature. You can't reform a thing. You have to abandon it totally. Most churches, psychological groups, all this sort of thing, whether small groups or big groups, are based on the illusion that you can reform your nature. And when you try to reform, you do nothing but make it worse. There's nothing to reform. There's only an illusion and an image. Which means you have to stop going to groups like this and deceiving yourself and contributing to the insanity. When you go to places like this and give your money and give your attention and give your interest, you're contributing to the insanity of the world. And you become a contributor to war, to riots. If you want to cease contributing to insanity, what's the first step? I have to be sane myself. Now, you tell me, in any way you like, comment please, and anything that occurs to you on the theme, the idea, it's the truth that hurts. How much truth can you take, for example?
I know that very, very well. But how to react to it rightly, that's the whole thing.
All right. Somebody else, please answer Rudy's question. He says he knows it's the truth that hurts, but how does he react to it? Now, you should know the answer. Yes?
Well, just finish saying that I think that if there's no me, there's no reaction. If you're not there,
right.
But that's not so easy.
See, you get hurt, right? Now, if that same man, that same false build-up cluster of images is going to react, it is going to make it worse, because it is going on to the next reaction. the dominoes in a row. One domino hits the next on and on, and they keep going. You get your feelings hurt, right? Someone says something that hurts your feelings. If it falls on you, what you call Rudy, you've got a second fault reaction. This is all mechanical behavior. This is mechanical emotions and mechanical thought. Then, for example, you will say, how come you hurt my feelings? You wouldn't put it that politely, you might outwardly. But you would be very angry and you'd suppress it because you still want something from this man or this woman. So you pretend you're not hurt. Now look what you've added. You've added a lie. You've said, I am not hurt. You may have said to him, oh, that's all right. You can speak frankly with me. That's a fib. So if it falls on what I call me at all, there can be nothing but endless mechanical reactions which will leave me worse off than before. So what do we do? Well, we're beginners here. So we're beginning to see how to respond. And it's very simple. I will ask you a question, and you see what you do with this. You hurt my feelings. You insult me in any way at all. I don't care how. You insult me. Why should I have a response at all? Why should I react to you at all? There is no reason on earth why I should respond in any way at all to your insult of me. There's no reason for it. There is a false reason, because you will find all kind of reasons. Little five-year-old kids. Mama, Billy, why did you hit Tommy? Tommy hit me first. Now, grown-up five-year-olds do this all day long. Anytime you get revenge on anyone, you're making yourself sicker. Anytime you respond with anger and hatred, I sit here amazed that it's so simple and we don't see it. Once more, and then I'll ask you. One point. I sit here right now in resentment of somebody. I probably won't know it. There might be some part of me that knows that I'm acting resentfully. Who is suffering from the resentment? Me. Right? And then what will I do? I'll go down and complain. Look how the world has treated me. Look how you have made me unhappy, never seeing that I have burned myself by loving my resentment, because by loving emotional agitation, I keep it going. Therefore, I can say I will not give up the idea of I being persecuted. Religious groups, social groups, love nothing better than to be persecuted. Without the persecution, they would have no reason for existence. Therefore, all unconsciously and deliberately, because they're asleep, they will stir up persecution. They're not stupid. They know what will make another group mad. March in the parade with a hostile sign. Don't you think they're not that stupid? They know when they read this sign, they're going to get the hostile reaction of someone standing over there on the curb. The way to make a neurotic more sick is to respond to his neurosis with your own. Right? Why should you respond at all to an insult? I will tell you why, and then you must comment. Because you're protecting, again, the false ideas you have about yourself, and it is terrifying to you to die to what you call yourself. Every day you die to some little idea about yourself, but first you have to see them. If you don't see it, if you're not watching yourself every second throughout the day, even right here now, if you're not observing it, you can't then give it up, which is why seeing it comes first. I see, I give it up. I'll have a fight. The old nature is going to fight you to the death to give up the slightest little bit of resentment. Because without it, you will be nothing. Why don't you try being absolutely nothing, no one, and see what happens? You'll never believe what will happen to you. It'll be fantastic beyond belief. And the first mistake you will make...
I'm not here.
then you are shocked to say, hey, you've fallen away from the faith. They were not interested in the first place. One of your greatest shocks is to see that very, very few human beings want to go this far. But that's a part of your growth too. And eventually comes to the point where you see a thousand things, including the fact you were not put here to save a world that doesn't want to be saved. Having saved yourself, that is what you have done. Now you're no longer insane, calling it sanity, therefore spreading your insanity out in the world in the name of sanity. Being sane, you know how to behave in all circumstances with all men. And it's completely effortless. There's nothing to do. What is there to do? I know. If we had new people here, they would say, you know what they'd say. They always say the same thing. People are never original in their objection. They would say, well, then life would become dull and unexciting. What would we do with ourselves? Why don't you find out what you do with yourself? Another reason they say this is because for the life of them, they can't see how they can carry on with life without sniping at their wife when they get home, without hating the boss at work. One of the greatest pleasures he has is hating that boss. They can't see how they can ever exist without this hatred. Because they call hatred life, and hatred is death, not life. Lack of hatred is life, right? Be serious. Be very serious about this, which is not grimness. Your life is at stake. Your life. Never mind about the man next to you. You be very much concerned with yourself. And don't call it selfishness. Call it common sense. What about the truth that hurts? What do you have to say?
Well, could you go into a little more of what really reminds on how to respond properly? See, we're beginners, and we see, the first thing is to see. So can you tell us, please, how we can work on this negative emotional reaction, even although we have become one with it, we've fallen under it?
I'll tell you one way, and I did hint at it in that answer, but I'll phrase it a different way. Always get a concrete situation, because you can connect it with your own life when you go home or with your friends or at work, neighbors or whatever. You have had your feelings hurt by something. Okay, so far? Think of it. You know where you get your feelings hurt. Okay. Have you noticed that ever since you were a small child that this has been a pattern? Mama said something, I feel bad. Mrs. Jones, the sixth grade teacher, said something about my study habits, my feeling get hurt. The boy took my place. It was my turn to come up to bat. He took my place. I got my feelings hurt. All right. For 30, 40, 50 years, I have responded in a certain way to these hurt feelings, these insults, these cutting things that really tore me apart. They do. We know that. You get torn apart. We know that. This is true. I have always responded in a certain way toward this. Now let me see if I can name as many as possible. I'm trying to clear my mind. Do you understand? I'm trying to clear my mind. I got angry when Bill took my place at bat. The bell was about to ring, and there was about 5 minutes for me to get a hit in, and he took my place at bat. And I felt real bad about it. I hated Bill. I couldn't study for the next 10 minutes in spelling class because I was still overtaken by this. The teacher said something, and I felt inferior. I felt dumb because this girl next to me, if you're in school, remember the smart kid? Huh? There was the dumb kid and the smart kid. We were somewhere in the middle. That smart kid, and you couldn't figure out how out of 10 problems, she could always get 10 of them. And if we got three, we were lucky. You know, and there's the dumb kid. That made us feel a little better. He could never get anything. We always see how we respond the same way to this. Now, are you following so far? I'm not meandering. I'm following a line here. I see that no matter what way I responded to relieve this ache, it never went away. Never. What happened is that the next time, and the situation being different, I tried another response, another way, whether it was anger or trying to console myself that the dumb kid always got 10 wrong and I only got 3 wrong, right, or whatever. No matter what I tried, the ache continued. On Monday, I tried something. Tuesday, the pain came back. Tuesday, I tried something else. Wednesday, the pain came back. Now, for heaven's sake, here I am, 30, 40, 60, 70 years old, and nothing has changed. We're getting close. We're getting close. Ooh, this is awful. I'll put it strongly, but I'm saying this lightly too, because there's no need to be grim. I have to see that for 70 years, I have made one horrible blunder out of my life. I can't lie anymore, and saying by striving to get a name for myself that I can erase this pain of being the dumb kid in class and of being the one of three kids who flunked I'm speaking personally now, in the B6, four kids, luckily wasn't one of them in this case, four kids were flunked and didn't get up to A6. And as a little kid, I studied them, and I watched the face of this woman, this girl, as she walked out of the classroom. That girl is being crushed today by that. That boy is. You know what I'm talking about. We're getting very close to home here. I have to see, nothing has worked. My despair, my agony, my pain, the drinking that I tried, the gambling that I tried, the chasing sex that I tried, the trying to find someone who would understand me. My God, what am I going to do? If we're fortunate enough to turn in the direction of what we're talking about here, of facing it instead of jumping off the bridge, instead of going into dope, or instead of going into an activity that will keep me away from the pain. A social activity is wonderful. I'll throw a party every other night. Of course, you'll have 50 people there. You're giving them free drinks. Anybody will come. See if they keep coming if you stop throwing parties. See if they keep coming around to your house. Do it. Stop giving the parties. Stop it and see what happens. If I have one small right thing within me, and if I'm fortunate enough to have run across the right book, the right speaker, the right group, no matter what it is, if I happen to have one small part of me that turns in the right direction, I have a chance. I have an opportunity. You have all had an opportunity, and don't you dare lose it. The worst crime you could commit against yourself in life would be to lose what you're getting here. Because I know, and you sense, maybe you know, that you're getting pure 100% truth here and nothing but that. That's why it does hurt occasionally, see? But it's very gentle. And we try to make it as hard as we can take below the breaking point where we would spill over into resentment or a blocked mind or whatever. If I can get in so much despair, this is answering the question, if I will get in despair, now let me tell you what it means to get in despair. It's so simple. I have to see that I am in despair. See, you can't deceive me here, if I may say so. You were all in despair. See? You watch how you reaction to what I just said. I know that you're all in despair. It's a matter of degree. I know that you're lost. This is not criticism. This is not condemnation. I'm saying this so that we can get out and get back. You can't say this on radio. You can't say these things on television. They would be bored by it and resentful, right? You can't say this to the world at large. This is for people who are getting a sense, an idea that they are in despair. Now, to finalize on this, and then I'll stop and you can come in. If I get the point where I'm willing, how can I phrase it? You tell me. I'm willing to let go, to die, to give up, to leap into the dark, not knowing what is going to happen to me, staying in it, trembling and shaking. I'm not being dramatic. I'm telling you this so you'll understand, because I know what you're going to have to do. Now, I'm trying to tell you, so then when it comes, it'll be easier, better, more understanding. And you sit there and shake, and it's not all alone. You could be shaking in your office when you're around the home, around someone. Stay there and shake. Don't do a single thing. You have nothing to do. You have nothing to do but stay there and tremble. The minute you run away with comfort by saying, if I get elected, then I'll erase this unconscious memory of being flunked in the sixth grade, you're lost again, see? Stay there with no references to any ideas at all in your mind. Stay and shake without thinking about it. Something will happen, something will change. You'll have to experience this. And when you feel for the first time this change, you'll want to have meetings every night. You'll be so eager, so anxious to get going. You'll see, I don't want to waste another minute. But you won't say, now listen to this, because your minds may have said this, you won't say, for God's sake, I've wasted 55, 60, 70 years. Don't think that at all. You start now. Don't live in time on this either. Never say you've wasted your life. If you are 80 years old and you suddenly find the truth, you have done a very wonderful thing and your life has not been wasted after all. If you're 80 years old, 90 years old. See that the old pattern has never worked, and it hasn't, has it? You wouldn't be here if it had worked. Stay right there and say it hasn't worked. It won't work. Then something in you will work for you. This is a tricky thing to say, because the lazy part of people's minds will say, someone will do the work for me. You have to do the work yourself. But the kingdom of heaven, which is indeed within, will then work for you. And you will say, this is what you'll say among other things, and you may not phrase it this way, but it'd be good if you phrase it this way. Here you are, at the point where you're going to turn, change, because you don't want to take it anymore. The pain is too bad. I'm sorry, I don't care what happens to me. I'm going to get out of this thing. And so you look out at the world. You look out at your friend, your wife, your relatives, sitting there, right in the room. There's eight of them right in the room, your relatives. And you say to them, quietly but very clearly, boy, people, if you knew how I'm going to change, and I know that you're going to have a reaction to how I'm going to change, sooner or later you will. I'm sorry, but regardless of what our relationship is, I'm not going to behave badly to you in any way. I'm not going to leave. I'm not going to stay. I'm just going to carry on with my life the way it is. Inwardly, I'm sorry. I'm walking on. You're not. I know in all probability you're not going to go with me, mother, 80-year-old mama, 81-year-old papa, 60-year-old wife, husband, even your children if you're that old. Your friends, your dear friends, whom you have been going out with all these nights and having parties, and you've kept each other in agony by lying to each other. Dear friends, I'm sorry, but I'm going on. You know what I'm talking about. You do it. You say that to yourself every day. And then you will be authentically helped. Something else will take over inside of you. And you'll meet a new crisis every day. You think you have problems now. Wait till you get going on this. Not new problems, but a consciousness of your old problems, which were there all the time. And you're shocked. It is not a new problem at all. You've lived with it all your life. It's been ripping you apart. But now you're seeing it. We're here because we have more or less agreed that we don't want to live this way anymore. So help between this lady, and this man, and this lady. Wonderful. Great. Because the very small parts in us that are right, many things wrong, but the right parts are joining forces. This is right organization, coming together of oneness. Because this thing that is right with you is the same little thing that's right with him. The little thing that's right with him, the same thing that's right with this lady. Now that it's double the power, see? You know what I'm talking about. Bear the pain. Whatever you do, bear the pain. What will they think of me? Not that you're going out. Don't you preach to anybody. You keep your mouth shut. Don't you dare preach to anyone about these things. They will begin to think different of you because your behavior is going to change. You're not going to go down to the beer hall and drink with them any night. Maybe you don't do that. Because you are very well aware of how they're going to react to this beginning change you have. He doesn't flatter me as much anymore. My husband doesn't flatter me as much anymore. You ought to be very grateful he doesn't flatter you, because he's imprisoning you, because you lap it up. Dare to do without false pleasure, which will now leave you all alone with nothing to feel good about. As you get rid of things to feel good about, you will get rid of things to feel bad about, because they're both the same.
Bring unconscious problems to the conscious level.
Just look.
Just keep looking all the time.
Okay. Right, yeah, just keep looking all the time. But let's add one more thing. See, we use strong words here. We can take strong words. Two phases. Step one, look. Step two, don't lie. Don't lie. I get angry. Okay, I look. I see my anger. Now, if I'm still mechanical, which I am, if I get angry in any way, I'm still on a mechanical, unconscious level. What do? I justify my anger. I have a right to blow up at you. Look what you did to me. See, I'm lying already. Already I've lost it. I am angry. Now, if I don't lie, I am angry. I can now go in the right direction, up instead of further down, because lying makes it worse. I lie. Now I can see, if I'm looking, other factors in this lie, or in my original anger, let's say. Why did I get angry at you? Because I am the head of the home, and as the head of the home, the wife and the three children, I am a very wise father. I know how to handle things properly. When decisions are made in this family, old Pop knows what to do. And at work, he's an executive too, so man, he's got it made. So something happens in the home, and the wife makes some little remark that exposes him as having terrible judgment in this particular problem. And Pop gets angry because his image of being the grand marshal, the head of the home, and the wise head has been challenged. Now if Pop would look at it and say, you know, that was a stupid thing, if it was, this is now getting onto other things, we can't get too specific, but he looks and sees that it was stupid judgment, then he has done the right thing first by seeing that he, what's happened, his image of being wise has been shaken. Now, let it be shaken to the point where it drops altogether. By the way, then he'll be really wise. See, this is false wisdom. Needing to be wise is false wisdom, because there's an I there that wants to be wiser than you. I am wiser than my wife. Therefore, I'm somebody. I'm smarter than her. Maybe the wife has her own particular images. So I can go on from my self-honesty to see many other things. And this will work out naturally with each one of you as you do it. Now you're thinking properly. And when you can see properly that this anger is destroying you, destroying me, then I drop it. I'm not going to hurt myself anymore. I've been living this way all my life. Anger is a giveaway, by the way. Right? You and I know that when you get angry and I get angry, something's wrong. And anger is one of the best things to work with in ourselves, because it's one of the most concealed. Because to be an angry person is considered socially undesirable. And what hypocrisy, for heaven's sake.
You talked about having parties every day to forget yourself. What about a person who thinks a hobby, for, you know, he's living his life wrongly and he's going to pursue the rest of his life in some kind of a hobby? What kind of a thing is that? Is that not an escape just like the rest of it?
It can be or it can't be. It depends on the man. And in almost every case, because there are so few awakened men on earth, hobbies are a distraction. If I'm a collector of seashells from Tasmania and Manhattan Beach, and I have, and all places in between, I get a sense of pride over my blue and coral seashells, and I display them when people come in the shelf. Who's the reflection on? See, if you had died to yourself and were an awakened human being, then simply because you were interested in that, that is not wrong in itself, and you're not using it for that, but you have to be very careful. You're not deceiving yourself. Why don't you collect seashells if that's what you like to do? But in almost every case, it is a matter of self-reference. Even if people don't look at your seashells, there's the idea of acquisition, of overcoming the challenge. There's only one square seashell in New Zealand, and I'm the man who persisted until he got it. In my own mind, I am a conquering hero. There is only one. I'm living in the idea of being a conquering hero. You may not know about it, but in my mind, 5 years, I won. And he goes to bed with nightmares, dreaming about square seashells. Nothing else other than the way my life, internal life, is presently being lived. This is the question I ask. If I'm deceiving myself, I will push that question away just as hard as I can, because it's disturbing to even look at it, because it disturbs my idea of being a satisfied person. Of course I'm satisfied. I have a nice husband, I have fine children, I have a home, our finances are not bad. Of course I'm satisfied. You are not satisfied at all. I doubt, who knows the exact figures, but I doubt if there's one person in, how many billion in the world now? Three billion, I think it is. It's going fast. I doubt if there are maybe how many, you tell me, 100 really satisfied men or women in the world? Satisfied in a different sense. Satisfied in the sense that you're not trying to satisfy anything. Why don't you give up trying to gain satisfaction and see what happens? You'll reach a crisis, and when you go through this crisis, meet another one. And go through that, and you'll meet another one. Whenever you open a door, there's another closed one in front of you. This is progress. This is progress. To see that 50 doors, surely the next one will be the last one. Never, never dare assume that the 50th will be the last one. Or you will be fixed at that level, and you'll never be able to go upstairs anymore. The only world that exists to a man is the world that he's in right now. So you have to leave that world and go up and open the next door. And keep going. As fast as you can.
What about the hobo on 5th and Main?
The hobo on 5th and Main. Shall I tell you? See, may I say something? Okay, look at the hobo on Skid Row at 5th and Main Street. He's got a beard, 8 days old, and his hair is messed up, and he's got an old coat on with a collar up like that, and you can see the bottle in his pocket, and he's got wine on his breath. I wonder if you know something. I'm not trying to be clever with words, but I want to tell you something. I'll tell you where that hobo lives psychologically. He lives 8 blocks down the street in a very respectable home. Only he doesn't have a beard and he doesn't have whiskey on his breath. He wears a tie and he has 3 club pins. Past president of the Tigers of America on his shirt, on his coat. And his wife gets her hair fixed at the beauty parlor twice a week at $25 a hairdo. There's no difference in bums. Seriously, there's no difference in bums. That man is maybe doing, I don't want to get opposites here, but that man may be doing far more damage socially than the man down at the rescue mission down there. Now please, do you really see this? Do you really see it? No, there's really no difference. There's no difference. It's just the exterior behavior in the two. This man here is a very dangerous man. He has a lot of power, maybe. He has a lot more power to hurt other people than the bum has, but don't think it opposite. The bum is, if the bum had a chance, he would be just as vicious. It's a matter of, look, do you know why one man is a million? Do you know why one man is a millionaire and another man is a bum? I'll tell you why. It has to do with many things, but if we get too many, we'll miss the point. Because of accidental happenings, including accidental happenings in choice in the mind. Here's 2 kids in the 6th grade. One does get, fails to go on to the, from the B6 to the A6, and that's a little thing. The other one by accident, because he happened to like mathematics and the other didn't like mathematics, he happened to make that, so he didn't get that. Life is made up in unconscious people with 1,000 accidents a day. You do not achieve any success whatsoever. You think you do. Let me tell you. You say, yeah, I read the stock report and that inside information, and I paid $80 for that, so it should be worth something. And it said, buy Lampshades of America. My little intelligent mind started thinking, Lampshades of America. And I studied the history of the company. Okay, I want 300 shares of Lampshades of America. You had nothing whatever to do with the fact that you chose it in the first place or that it went up and you became a wealthy man. And the other kid who didn't buy Lampshades of America, and he just happened to turn left instead of right in seeking employment when he was 18 and out of high school, he's a bum. He ends up a bum on Skid Row. Psychologically, there's no difference. No one achieves anything. Nothing. You don't believe that. I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why you have never achieved anything. Because you don't exist. You stop and think for a minute, and then we'll go on. You don't exist at all as someone who can do anything. Everything that's happened to you has been a pure accident. This is why you had better stop bragging about your successes, because now you're going to be in terrible despair when that gets away from you, which it may do. It may not. You may, by the law of accident, be wealthy from the day you're 20 years old to the day you die. You may be a famous and popular man, but you may still be a psychological bum. And if you haven't found the truth, then you are. Get over the idea that you can achieve a thing. Now I'll tell you, when you have gone all the way through this and you understand this, that you don't exist in the sense that you think you do exist, but not in the sense you think you do, then you're free of everything, including the need to be either a success or a failure. Because there's a good deal of vanity in being a failure as well as in being a success, because there's still a you there. See, bums have just as much egotism as the so-called successes. You owe me that turkey dinner. Look at the way my wife left me and I didn't do a thing. That's why I'm an alcoholic, because my wife left me. I'm not criticizing. This is a pathetic thing for both people. There's no difference. It's equally pathetic. We're not here to criticize. For God's sake, I want out. I want you out. I want you to help me get out. We're not criticizing anyone. We're all psychological bums. You look, you look back in your life and you tell me how wonderful you are, and I'll look at you very carefully, right? So, everything is accidental. Now, when you're free, therefore, whatever happens to you, okay, who cares? I don't exist to success or failure. Okay, did you want to make the comment now?
Well, I don't think it's anything that's fantastic. It's just that I was thinking that when he was referring to the bum on Main Street, that sometimes if we point the finger at somebody like that, then we don't have to really look at ourselves.
Yes.
To see what's doing with us. So that's usually why we find somebody less fortunate than we are.
And you know something else that will increase our sickness? Now follow this, because I'm going to make it say it, and then I want to go on. Something else that will increase our sickness is feeling, now don't jump, stop when I finish this sentence, is feeling sorry for the bum down there. That will make you sicker. You understand? I am sorry for the bum. I am not a bum myself. See how nice I am being sorry for the bum. And if I can give $10 to the rescue mission, that increases my sickness even more. Because I see how wonderful I am by comparison. Some of your sickest people are those who are helping sick people. Isn't that a marvelous escape? To be a good person out in the world, saving the world. What a marvelous escape from my own sickness. Have you been, have you watched religious rallies lately on television? Isn't that marvelous? If I can save you, I can get my mind off of my own problems. Yes, go ahead.
I'm starting to get a very funny feeling that I think in my conscious mind that I want this truth, but I have a very funny feeling that deep down I don't really want it. Because if I did, it wouldn't be such a struggle. And could I be completely deceiving myself to think that I want it when I really don't?
No. Look, we are not one person. We, this lady, this man, this lady, maybe 500 different people inside of ourselves. And each of these people are made up of this desire, that wish to get prominence, public prominence, to have power, to have authority, to have comfort, to be told that we're loved, and things like that. All right, okay, we've got all these. Now, if you are slightly awake, we're outnumbered at the beginning. We're outnumbered. We have 499 bad parts in us to one good part. This is why you have to hang on. So as to hang on to this one good part to find out, because you're going to get overwhelmed. People who come to this meeting, or any right meeting, and there are a few, you've been to some of them, for the first time, go out just as asleep as they were before. For one split second, in the middle of that meeting, one decent part of them woke up, just for a second. And boy, they're excited. I'm going out in the lobby and buy all the books. When's the next meeting? They go out, and the first thing that happens, usually the wife or the husband ruins it for them. Or a lover. And they start criticizing what they heard. And this person who had this one little good part in them has lost all possibility of ever awakening. Now, you have, everybody has, not everybody, you have to judge for yourself. One small part of you that wants to wake up, but it's overwhelmed by all these other lies. This is why I'm telling you, don't you dare just dabble around in this. You go all out. You let everything go and plunge into the darkness of this. It's the only way you wake up. Don't use a spoon. Get a sledgehammer. Knock on that door. And be ruthlessly, I'm talking deliberately, be ruthlessly persistent. You hammer on that door until it breaks down. If it takes you all week, if it takes you all week to understand one little tiny idea, that's wonderful. if you sledgehammered this door down to get this one thing, if you got the one idea that I can't go on in my old ways anymore, that is good, because that'll make you even worse off. It'll put you in more conscious despair, which is the beginning of the end of despair. So hang on. Get up the psychological sledgehammer and pound away at it. Someday, when you're not 30, 40, 50, 60 anymore, and you're 80, you'll be so glad. If you come to a meeting for the first time and something right flares up in you and you go away and you're taken over again by your old habit systems, which is tremendous force, when you're 80, you'll never have known what you missed. You'll never know it. No one will ever be able to tell you. If you're asleep, you're asleep, period. A sleeping man does not know he's asleep, and that's the whole story. You can't talk to a sleeping man about anything. Don't waste your breath. Put yourself on, this is what it amounts to. Put yourself on your own side. The side of your real nature, instead of this phony imposter who has been making you so miserable all these years. You have so many problems. Say nothing of psychological problems, problems maybe with finances, of how to earn your living. I'm very glad if you have financial problems and you don't know what to do with them. I'm very happy for you. Because maybe that will be the thing that will wake you up. Then, as I've said before, when you're awakened, you can eat bread and butter, bread and margarine if you can't afford butter, and coffee and tea, and you will sit down and be a happy human being eating toast and butter and tea. And where's the problem? The problem comes when you say, I must have steak. If you don't say, I must have steak, you will never be dissatisfied with toast and tea. It's a psychological problem. And you won't waste what little money you have on stupid things. I would say that 99% of spending is stupid. It is wise to buy toothpaste and bread and tea, coffee. It is wise to buy new tires for the automobile because they're getting thin and dangerous. Try to see the difference between stupid spending and wise spending. Start with that. Reduce your needs, which will come naturally after a while because you won't want anything. What do you want? I want a roof and I want tea and toast, but for heaven's sake, what else on earth do I want? You have nothing to give me. You're saying this. You have nothing to give me.
Now, see, I have this one good eye and I'm just at the very beginning. And I feel that life is closing in on me. I can see that if I did something, what can I do to help my good eye, in other words? To give it more strength.
More strength. All right. Will each of you please tell the lady what would help strengthen her? Each one contribute something. All right, I will give you one and maybe someone else will give you. And it's a repeat, but it's so good. You want to strengthen this one little good part.
Yes.
You still have plenty of despair in you. Mm-hmm. I want you to be just as discouraged, in just as much despair. I want you to be totally lost. I want you to be totally lost. I don't want you to hang on to anything. You see how lost you can make yourself psychologically. Don't do stupid things. Don't walk out in the front of a car. You'll be psychologically lost so that you don't know what to do. Look. From the time you started to think a little bit for yourself, 6 years old, you knew the answers. Oh, yes, you did. Papa and Mama gave you these answers, and that school teacher gave them to you, and the preacher gave you the answers. Where is your life as a result of these answers that you hang on to? Don't tell me how to live. I know what to do. Don't tell me not to go down and join these clubs. This is an organization to bring about world peace, and I'm a part of it. Don't you tell me I shouldn't join these things. Ha! You tell me what your inward life is like. You be in total despair. That will wake you up. If you will be in total despair, instead of lying about your despair, about your suffering, about your agony, you're living in hell and you lie about it. Why don't you tell the truth about it? Not egotistically. Don't go around telling people your troubles. You're relieving your troubles when you tell other people about them. You're trying to get comfort. Then they have to take their turn telling you their troubles, and you sit there bored. You want to tell everybody else your troubles. Don't trade like this. Can you see how nervous you are with your boss, with your girlfriend, with your wife? See, just see how nervous you are. And ask yourself if you want to continue to be nervous all your life. I don't want to be nervous, do you? But you think it's necessary. Nervousness itself is a protection. It's an attempt to feel something other than fear of the boss, that he might fire me. I get nervous, I feel a little relieved, because I'm nervous and I feel as if this is protective. Why don't you not be nervous the next time you fear somebody and see what happens? Don't you retreat to being scared. Being scared is an escape. Be scared. You understand? It's hard to explain. Be scared and do nothing but be scared and see what happens. But don't love it. Don't love the state. See what happens. Everything we're doing, to answer the lady's question, everything we're doing here is calculated to strengthen us, the good parts in us, everything. You're getting proper encouragement here. This is right encouragement. Being the truth. Nothing is more heartening, more cheerful than the truth itself. And if someone tells you and gives you false encouragement, don't listen to them. If someone tells you, we're caught by words, but I'm going to have to say it this way. If someone tells you, buck up and be strong, don't listen to them. You buck down and be weak. Because that is your condition, being weak. When you do this, you destroy the lie that you know the answer. We're here to destroy lies that we have the answers. I will ask you probably about the fifth time. All these precious answers that you cling to, what have they given you? What's your inner life like? See? Be shocked by what you see in yourself. And then the only reward, the whole reward, the total reward, is to be a whole, decent human being. The most difficult thing in the world is to try to be good. The easiest thing in the world is to be good. There's no you that can be good. There is goodness, and if you are goodness, and goodness is you, it's effortless. God, truth, reality, doesn't have to be what it is. That bush doesn't have to try to be anything but what it is. It is one unit, one fir bush, whatever it is. No effort to become a rose tree or a pine tree. It is what it is, therefore it's unified. No effort to be the goodness of being a fir bush. See? One thing. No desire to be anything else. Now you're really good. Now, because you have put an end to self-injury, you're not going to hurt him or this lady. You can't. You can't be evil. God can't be evil. Do you understand what I'm saying? God can't be evil. Impossible. Reality can't be evil. The hoaxer, the stage performer, the actor, the smiler, the dynamic personality can be vicious to the point of killing, and does, millions of human beings, causing suffering to 12-year-old children with bombs. An unawakened man has no conscience whatsoever. None. You think he has a little conscience? He has exterior morality which will last as long as it suits his ego purposes. When you have died to your false sense of self, there is goodness which is you, but no you and goodness. If I say I am good, I am lying. If I say there is goodness, period, that is the truth. But there's no me there who brags about and lies about being good. It's clear, isn't it?
I think the most difficult thing is to keep remembering that when we're going through the despair, the agony, the pain, that we are it. And then if something comes along where we start to feel a little better, we might lose the reason for wanting to break out. And then I would say, certainly the study, a study group, a group that gets together because they want to help each other. Books are very, very helpful. Books that remind us that we are in this desperate state and that there is a way out. I found the tapes to be very, very helpful because it's in addition to the books, I mean, it's a reminder that there are people that I'm not working alone on this, that there are others who want freedom also, and I hear how they're working together, and it's giving me more of an understanding of how to start to break out.
Do you know why this is true encouragement? There's nothing false in this. If every one of us here have one small part of us, I'm repeating, but I'm going to say it a different way. Every one of us have one small part of us that wants out. You know what that means. That is truth. Therefore, this man, by saying something and being here and talking and speaking up and going back and forth, this man is giving me this bit of truth that he has. He's giving it to me. This lady is giving it to this man. This lady to this man. What are we doing? We're awakening truth in us, which is real encouragement. So that's a wonderful thing. And I'll tell you, you recognize it, don't you? There's something in you that has been sitting and observing all this, and you've been feeling this way deep down inside, haven't you? You know it's true. That is wonderful. That's great. That's something very pure. Now, keep working on it. Keep encouraging it, because when we go out in the world, most people, and if you stay awake, you have to stay awake every time, it will be overcome. You'll find yourself taken over by a very evil little part of you, maybe. And it'll surprise you. That lady got in front of your place in the checking out, and she has 80 items and you have one. Watch your reaction. You were taken over. We're looking for what is wrong with us in order to end it. Not looking for flattery and mutual deception in order to keep each other comforted but miserable. Yes, go ahead. Yeah.
There is fatigue. I think, I'm not sure what you said, but you can help me out possibly. At one time you said that we're allowed to get tired, but not allowed to react or something.
I think I may know what it is. I may.
Now, be this true. Is fatigue, this is something that we have to be aware of, because our reaction, though we may be observing and trying to be aware, our reaction may be faster or whatever. We may not be as able to watch it if we become fatigued and tired.
I think maybe, you can correct me, I said something like this. You're certainly allowed to be physically tired and hungry. The man works hard at the office all day and he comes home tired and hungry. He is not permitted to let that spill over into his psychology and become irritable. See, that is wrong. Obviously, your body's going to get tired and you're going to get hungry. But if you use that as an excuse, well, I have a right to snap at my wife. You know the things that happened down there at that office? 5 people interfered with what I was trying to do. See, the man is mad. You want to see mad people? Look at people who are complaining about what people do to them. You're looking at mad people. That's not for us. That's not. If I see that I am tired after a hard day's work, and I may be, maybe I work hard, and I'm hungry, and no chance for a snack or whatever I do, so I come, but I'm working, and I walk into the door, and my wife usually has dinner on, and boy, tonight I can hardly wait because I just want to flop down and sit down and eat and watch television after. And she was out somewhere and didn't get back. She was over her sister's house, who I don't like very much anyway. And dinner isn't ready. At this minute, I'm tired of being a slave, all these bad things. I catch myself. What an opportunity to pounce on her, get back at her. I can't get back at those bosses. They'll fire me. I get her to get back at. I don't do it this time. I catch myself in time, and I say, ever since I got failed in the sixth grade, this has been my reaction, to jump on somebody in order to try to make myself feel better. At least I've restored myself. I am your dictator. I may get dictated and tyrannized at work, but here's my opportunity. I catch myself and don't let it spill over. I see that I'm physically tired and worn out. I'm sorry, I'm not going to destroy myself. So I catch myself. See, already I'm beginning, just, I'll slip many times, beginning to be a decent human being. Instead of hurting her, and I get great pleasure in hurting her, by the way, don't I? I know what your face is going to express when I pounce on you. I may not cry, but I can see the moisture in your eyes, because when you get emotional, I can see them. That makes me feel good. I am mad. I'm insane. I should be locked up. But I catch it. And this is what I do for weeks, for months, for years. And every time I catch myself starting to become mad, and I catch it with this one right thing in me, then there's two right things and 498 mad parts of me. And when I, look, now I'll tell you another thing. I come home, I fail, I don't catch myself, I'm not aware. I snap at her, I get the thrill, I always get a thrill. By the way, she's just as mean as I am. You understand? Don't think there's any difference. She's simply, on the human level, the dominated one. But she's cruel to the kids. Don't ever think there's any difference. I'm simply speaking this way. So I hurt her. And she's silent for an hour, because when she gets mad, she doesn't blow up, she clams up, see? And I know it, and we know it, and we come back to you. I'll have to tell you. An hour later, I wasn't able to catch it then, because I'm still too mechanical. I catch it then. Now I don't make any further blunders. I don't go over, and the way I used to do for our 20 years of our marriage, and go over and say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I did this, I won't do it again. I may do it again. I'm watching myself first, and I may apologize in a certain way, but I don't do it in a way that destroys her, because she says, you were wrong, I cut. Is this the way? Sick people are sick, period. They always do the wrong thing. I'm saying that I'm not able to catch it at the time, but I'm able to do it later, because this is the stage I'm at. Therefore, what do? I see that I had hurt myself by letting it go beyond, not catching it at the moment. That is healthy. Maybe a day goes by. Then the next time, when I come in the door, and maybe it's even worse at work this time, but I'll have remembered that experience, and I'm now able to work for me, and I say, right now, stop right now. I'm sorry. It isn't going to go this way anymore. 40 years it's been this way. This is the end. Old friend. So I catch myself this time. Not repressing my anger. Repression is not the same thing as ending it, right? I'm not pushing it down in order to, maybe I want some from her, maybe I want sex from her that night, and I know how she can use that weapon against me, so I suppress my anger in order to get what I want tonight, later tonight. I do it because I don't want to be mad anymore, therefore I become more decent towards her. That was a long answer to a short question.
In other words, we see everything in the present with the eyes of the past. We're bringing everything, all our reactions are from the past.
Yes.
Our past condition, and we think we're seeing things as they are right now, but it's just an illusion. Everything is connected from, say, 30, 40 years.
Right, right. And we react from that.
Right.
But we don't know that because we haven't understood the idea of time yet. Very briefly, very briefly. The ordinary mind that we use in everyday affairs does live in time because it's made up of memories and you remember these things. Therefore, you react a certain way because you've always reacted that way based upon your childhood experiences, whether you failed in the sixth grade, a thousand and one things, your parents' political beliefs and all that, religious beliefs. So you respond that way because you've always responded that way. But this is in the level of time. If I'm wide awake, let's say I'm wide awake, and I'm physically tired, hungry, like I've been working hard, and I come home, and the table isn't set, and that's just the beginning of it. All kind of other things are wrong. The TV set broke down, and I just wanted to see that program tonight because it helped with my business or whatever. Six things go wrong. The troubles are piled on. If I'm awake, where's the problem? Problem arises when I reach back into my mind and feel frustrated that I don't get that TV program, that the dinner isn't ready, that that wife who owes it to have that dinner on the table doesn't have it. None of these thoughts go through my mind. I'm a free human being. I don't know how to react. Therefore, I'm free. If I know how to react, looking back, yesterday I blew up and I felt power. That doesn't exist anymore. I've died to that vanity of wanting to have power over her. Right now, there's no reaction. Where's the reaction? How can I react at all? Which doesn't mean I'm not aware that the table isn't set. See? You understand? You see everything. You see that the TV set doesn't work, but there's no reaction there. There's no pain there. There's no time there. There's no accumulated I there. The accumulated I has died. It's gone, it's free. I and now are one. I and God, truth, reality, are one. Therefore, I'm free. Therefore, I don't destroy myself and I don't destroy you. Do you see how it works? This is why you must, and if you want to be really decent, make yourself decent. Nothing else, no one else. Don't you pay attention to the world who doesn't want to be saved. Save yourself. They won't know it. You may be wide awake and your wife won't know it. She may be asleep. She may never awake. If it happens that way, it could happen that way. No one else is going to know it. And you don't say, see, I'm awake and you're asleep. But you know it. But you're not boasting about it. Because that would have to go too. There's no I to boast. You see instead. Then, on the everyday level, everything is handled perfectly. The wife didn't get home in time for the dinner. She got held up. The car broke. Whatever happened. Well, let's see. I will set the table. I'll get things going as fast as I can because I assume I'm hungry. Get going as fast as I can on that one. I am not going to destroy myself. That is the main thought in my mind. Sorry. It's all over. This is real revolution. Real revolt. Bob, comment.
What did you start out with your first basic question? The truth that hurts.
Yeah, that's what we started with.
I sometimes wonder, is this the suicidal tendencies inherent in human nature? Is this come from taking a good observation in ourselves and not liking the untruths that we see about ourselves?
Okay, all right. When I get hurt about anything, you tell me now. I've been telling you. You tell me. If I get hurt, what gets hurt? You tell me. Sure. This phony idea I have about myself. My real nature, this kingdom of heaven within, cannot be hurt by anything. My idea about myself can be hurt. I have an idea. You should treat me nicely. You should honor me and respect me. You don't, I get hurt. I get hurt because I had this idea that you should honor and respect me. And you pretend to be loyal to me and then you leave me for someone else and I get hurt. It's my fault. And probably if I'd been more awake, I wouldn't have even taken up with this person to begin with. Because boy, I'll tell you, you'll be able to spot human nature a mile away. And you know that everybody is alike, right? You're smiling, you know that's true. All of you are smiling. Because there's something deep down inside all of us that knows that that smiling conqueror has a knife in his pocket. If we have the smiling conqueror in us, we will join with him against a third party to get what we want, and we'll both be ruined. Therefore, I have to get the smiler with a knife out of me. Then I'll stay away from the smiler with a knife over there. Yes?
Well, most people that are sleeping tend to shy away from meetings like this. I was wondering, is there any danger in a sleeping person that comes to this meeting?
Danger?
Really, yes. Really,
none at all.
Really doesn't want to wake
up. Nope. I'll tell you what protects him. Protects in quote marks. A wall that thick and up there. Really? Now listen, listen. He does not hear. That is his protection.
It buffers all around.
Sure.
And doesn't
sure.
Even touch him.
No, nothing. No. In fact, you'll smile at this. We're talking about hypocrisy, and there's the biggest hypocrite on earth who's come in here, sitting there. A big hypocrite. Well dressed, tie, button, big hypocrite. And we start to talk about the badness of hypocrisy. He'll stand up and give a speech on the evils of hypocrisy. Doesn't touch him at all. He never sees himself as he is. He's living in ideals that he is not a hypocrite. You can insult him. Well, maybe, sir, maybe you've got a little hypocrisy in you. He'll smile. Nothing.
Someplace you said all unawakened persons are pouncers.
Nah.
Sitting around waiting for any advantage. This is what is easy to look within ourselves and see the little pouncing things that we like to do
right.
For our own ego gratification.
Right. That's
this
good.
Is a way that I can work on me.
Right. At work, Bob, you do it at work where you are. Which does not mean you're not efficient in your work. If a young employee makes a mistake, you say, Bill, you should have put that over there and so on. That's good. Watch how you are when you reprove someone. If you say, Bill, that book goes on that shelf instead of on that shelf, on the level of ordinary rightness, you may be right. That book should be over there, and it should go over there. Watch your attitude in saying that. Do you feel superior? You feel that you've got someone to boss after you go home and your wife bosses you. I've got you to boss. Watch yourself. Yeah. Then your pouncing will slow down and stop eventually because there'll be no one there needing to prove itself. Then you will tell Bill to put the book on that shelf to that shelf casually. You won't even have to think about it. Bill, put that over there. It's under A instead of Z. That's the end of it. It's marvelous to work in everything that happens to you in your home. When you're all alone, work with your own mind. See what you're thinking. This appears to be dreamy and evil to sleeping people. When you begin to awaken, you see it as factual, nothing but fact, just plain practical fact and liberation. People have it the exact opposite, see? And when we start, this is a threat. Right? This truth is a threat. Who is it a threat to? Our phoniness. So it becomes our task to increase the threat, to come back and be more receptive, to be hurt more and more and more. Then we begin to get the idea that we have to die to what we've been protecting. And the death of this hoaxer, this stage performer, is the beginning of life, real life, which there's no self there at all to protect. Isn't it wonderful not to have to protect anything? Nothing. What are you protecting? I will ask you, if you're a free human being, what are you trying to protect? What are you trying to get? You may make $50 a week or $10,000 a week, and if you're free, it makes no difference whatever. None. Because you will see that you had nothing to do with making this $10,000. You think you did. You really think you did. Your great wisdom in investing in stock on that certain day, that was pure accident, and you somehow know it. But of course, if the stock fails, then you blame somebody. But if it goes up, you credit yourself. That's logic.
What about the difference in technological brain power? The one person that can excel because of being so technologically advanced, while another doesn't have...
Well, that's nothing more than intelligence on the everyday level. Sure. A man may be a brilliant scientist. Another man may be a mediocre scientist. Third man, a very poor scientist. That has nothing to do with our inner life. They could all be lost and probably are. What's that? He's merely studied hard, or he had a great interest in it. Anything you're interested in, really interested in, you can go fast in. There are many factors, but we're talking about the inner life. That's all. He may be the most brilliant scientist on earth, and he may have sick nightmares every night. So what does it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? I don't want to be miserable anymore. That's why I'm here. That's why you're here. That's enough. Why don't you start with that and stick with that? That's enough. What else do you want? Now work. Work. I don't want to be miserable anymore. I don't want to be nervous anymore. That's great. Wonderful. Hooray for you. Hooray for me. I don't want to be afraid of growing old. I don't want to be afraid of thinking that I was born with certain physical disadvantages. I'm 5 feet and weigh 300 pounds. I don't want to... I'm sick and tired of thinking of what you think about my physical appearance. Or I'm not very good looking. God, I want the whole thing out. Not being angry anymore. I want the whole business out. Don't compromise. You say you want the whole business out. Anyone would like to say anything in conclusion?
Oh, how difficult this is to get these emotions. I had two long-distance telephone calls yesterday, and one of my co-workers demanded immediate attention. And the little bit of anger that I displayed to that reaction, I have paid for today.
Right.
Many fold.
Right. Right. You're beginning to see the penalty of the whole business, right? It's good. Very good. When I see what I do to myself, sooner or later, I will say, I am no longer going to start slapping myself on the head. What a stupid thing to slap myself on the head all day long. That's what it amounts to. When we see self-defeat, we'll end with this. When I see self-defeat as self-defeat, really see it, and this takes work, it stops right now. That's the end. No more.
Copyright 1973. No portion of this material may be reproduced or sold without permission from Bruno Associates, Garden Grove, California.